Ancient Aliens is an American television series which premiered on April 20th, 2010 on the History Channel. The program presents the so-called ancient astronaut theory, which is the idea that extraterrestrials visited the Earth in the ancient past, and that historical texts, archaeological records, and various legends contain evidence of this contact. I used to believe that the ancient astronaut theory was true. I spent years learning about it from the popular authors, from video presentations and radio shows. I was an enthusiastic promoter of this idea to my friends and family. Although I no longer feel that way, I want you to know that I have no personal reasons to reject this theory. My current worldview could easily accommodate the existence of extraterrestrials. I hope you will come away from this film, even if you disagree with it, saying that I fairly reviewed the claims of ancient aliens without bias and with respect. I hope to show you that this is not a matter of ancient aliens getting a few details wrong here and there and their main premise remaining true. That is not an option in my opinion. I hope to demonstrate to you that they are wrong not on some, but on every single point where they assert an ancient astronaut theory to explain evidence, and that often they are using deceptive means to do this, and sometimes even fabricating evidence to make their points, as we will see. I would also like the viewer to know that unlike many skeptics of the ancient astronaut theory, I actually concede that something out of the ordinary could have occurred in the ancient past, and that there are certain consistent themes in ancient mythologies and the like that require good explanations. But I think you will quickly see that the ancient astronaut theories do not explain this evidence. I'll be joined by commentary from Dr. Michael Heiser, one of the few actual scholars who has been willing to interact with the ancient astronaut theory. Dr. Heiser has been one of the most articulate proponents of the skeptical viewpoint of this theory, and has written papers and books, as well as almost a dozen websites on the issues we will be covering in this film. We are happy to have him as a part of this film, and we're happy to have you, the viewer, here as well. I encourage you to have an open mind and enjoy the film.
In the ancient texts of Sumeria, we have descriptions of these beings descending from the sky called the Anunnaki. The term Anunnaki means those who from the heavens came.
This is entirely wrong. The word Anunnaki means princely seed or princely blood. The idea is that the Anunnaki were direct creations of Anu, who was regarded as the father and king of the gods. As we will see, this is the main idea associated with the Anunnaki in the minds of the Sumerians. That is, that the Anunnaki were directly created by Anu. And so it makes sense that even their name reflects this idea. That is, that they were the offspring of the prince.
The term itself means of royal seed or princely seed, because the Anunnaki were considered the offspring of Anu or An, the great god of heaven. And also we have, again, Anunnaki. They were also the offspring of An and his consort, Ki, the heaven and earth. This divine coupling, the way the Mesopotamians conceived their pantheon.
So if the term Anunnaki means princely seed or offspring of the prince, how is it that ancient aliens says that the word Anunnaki means those who from heaven to earth came? The short answer is that everything that ancient aliens says here about the Anunnaki comes from a man named Zachariah Sitchin. Sitchin wrote many books claiming that the Anunnaki were really aliens. Unfortunately, at the time that he wrote this, in the 70s, there weren't many ways for ordinary people to see if what he was saying was true or not. To put it simply, Sitchin's translation of the word Anunnaki is wrong.
Now, you'll often read, especially in the writings of Zachariah Sitchin, that the Anunnaki means something like, you know, they who from heaven came, or again, some other sort of description that makes them sound like aliens or extraterrestrials. There isn't a source on the planet by any Sumerian scholar that would agree with that definition. Again, it's not a difficult term. I personally don't think that Sitchin knew Sumerian at all, because if you're going to get even a term associated with a very important group of deities, if you're not going to get that right, then I have to wonder what else you're going to get wrong.
Sitchin claimed to be an expert on Sumerian writings. Yet we can now see that he didn't seem to even understand the basic grammar and vocabulary rules of the Sumerian language. Several real scholars challenged him on his translations and on his lack of any academic credentials in the field, pointing out that there is no record of Sitchin having anything but a journalism degree. One such scholar is Dr. Michael Heiser.
To this day, I haven't been able to find, nor have other people whom I've asked to help, people who like Sitchin, I've never been able to find any actual credentials of him knowing any of the languages or being credentialed in any way in ancient Near Eastern studies.
As we progress and look into some of the specifics of Sitchin's views, articulated here by ancient aliens, I think you will see that determining the truth about this difficult subject is not out of the hands of the common person.
It says, word for word, that these beings descended in flying vehicles from the sky.
This is a preposterous statement. I challenge anyone to produce this word for word text. You can do a search online and literally see all the references to the word Anunnaki in the Sumerian texts. The only time it refers to anything even close to this is when it talks about the Anunnaki being direct creations of Anu in heaven. A few examples of this would be the Anunna, the gods whom An conceived in the sky, or the Anunna whom An in the sky conceived. These texts emphasize the point that the main Sumerian concept regarding the Anunnaki was that they were directly created by An. That's what's being said here. The idea that the texts say that they descended out of flying vehicles is pure fiction, and that's the nicest way that I can think of to say that. What Ancient Aliens does here is they show pictures of the winged solar disk as they talk about the Anunnaki, and I guess they expect the audience to think that these texts speak of these disks like spacecraft in the Sumerian stories, when in fact the solar disks seen in the iconography are not associated with the Anunnaki at all, but rather with the sun and or the sun god. This is probably why Tsoukalos says the following.
And they were always described or depicted in floating above some quote-unquote regular people.
Since the Anunnaki are never depicted floating above people's heads, we can see that they want people to believe that the solar disk icon equals the Anunnaki spacecraft. This is wrong for several reasons. Number one, the solar disks in the Sumerian culture really did represent the sun or the sun god. The sun traveling across the sky every day was seen to have been facilitated by wings on the sun. You need to know that there is nothing in these descriptions of the sun in the Sumerian texts that would suggest that they were really talking about a UFO. As boring as it may be, they were really talking about the sun. One way to demonstrate this is found in the Epic of Gilgamesh. Gilgamesh worships Shamash, the sun god, in order to get favor for part of his journey. And he does this by facing east in the morning, that is, in the direction of the rising sun. The idea that Ancient Aliens proposes here, that the Anunnaki actually came out of the solar disks, or that they were pictured riding in them, is just a lie. There's no way around it.
We can find not only descriptions of the Anunnaki, but also depictions. And we can see them in statues, in carvings. So it's all very interesting to see that those beings looked like modern-day space travelers with weird suits. Some of them wore wristwatches, they had boots on, and helmets, and above all, wings.
All throughout the Ancient Alien series, they show these pictures of Akkadian winged genies and refer to them as Anunnaki. But funnily enough, winged genies aren't Anunnaki. In fact, these reliefs aren't even Sumerian, they're Akkadian. But hey, while we're here, we might as well explain what's going on in these images, even though they have absolutely nothing to do with the Anunnaki. The belief was that certain aspects of nature were controlled by these winged genies. Most notably, they were responsible for the fertilization of the crops. They were often depicted with a bucket of pollen or water in one hand, and a group of male flowers or a pine cone in the other hand. They often are depicted as fertilizing a date tree, which was a symbol of fruitfulness. Sometimes they would be depicted as being pointed at the king, which because of the accompanying inscriptions, we know means that the king was seen to be a type of intermediary between the gods and responsible for the fruitfulness of the land and the people. One way to demonstrate this is by explaining what Ancient Aliens calls a wristwatch. First, you should take note that if this is a watch, then these genies were serious about timekeeping, because they wore one of these on both wrists and often on a headband as well. This watch is actually an Akkadian symbol for Ishtar, the goddess of fertility. You can see the same rosette on the famous Ishtar Gate in Babylon. The fertility of the land was associated with, as you might expect, the goddess of fertility, and these beings are depicted as acting on behalf of Ishtar as they fertilize this date tree. This also probably explains the wings, considering that the natural and visible way that a flower is pollinated is through bees and birds. Therefore, it's not so hard to see that they were depicting their spiritual agents of pollination with wings as well.
Zechariah Sitchin has essentially suggested that the reason why we were visited in the remote past is because the ancient astronauts' home planet needed gold for their atmosphere, and that their gold content in the atmosphere was depleting. So they came to Earth in order to mine gold and bring it back to their home planet.
This idea about aliens coming to mine gold for their atmosphere in the ancient past is widely repeated by ancient astronaut theorists. In fact, it's become something of a foundational idea in the movement. This idea traces directly back to Zechariah Sitchin and has absolutely nothing to do with Sumerian texts. It's interesting to note that Sitchin doesn't even give a place in the Sumerian texts to justify this notion that they needed gold for their atmosphere. He says the following in his book, The Wars of Gods and Men. The metal, with its unique properties, was needed back home for a vital need. As best as we can make out, this vital need could have been for suspending the gold particles in Nibiru's waning atmosphere and thus shield it from critical dissipation. So he says, as best as we can make out. Well, who is we? And what text would even hint at that idea? Sitchin never says. He simply creates this idea of gold particles being needed in a planet's atmosphere out of nowhere. Nowadays, you can do a word search for the uses of the word gold in the Sumerian texts. We can read every mention of this word. Not only are the mentions of the word gold relatively few in the Sumerian texts, there is nothing to indicate anything but the most ordinary uses for gold. In fact, it's a surprisingly boring study. Thanks to the meticulous cataloging of the Sumerian texts over the last few decades and the advent of the internet, we no longer have to take people like Sitchin's word for it.
There are some databases online that allow you to search through Sumerian texts. And I have a video on my website, www.sitchiniswrong.com. If you go there and you click on the Anunnaki tab, I will show you how to search through something called the Electronic Text Corpus of Sumerian Literature. I'll show you how you can search for all the occurrences of the word Anunnaki, and then click through to English translations of all those occurrences. You can find this material, and I would encourage you to do so, because you can check up on Zechariah Sitchin, you can check up on me. When I claim that there are no texts, there are no tablets that have, for instance, the Anunnaki on Nibiru or associated with Nibiru, that Nibiru isn't a planet beyond Pluto, when I say those things, how easy would it be to prove me wrong if you knew how to search for those terms? It'd be real easy. And I encourage you to check up on me, check up on everybody else, and do the work. You can access this material and know who's telling you the truth.
We can finally see for ourselves why the Sumerian scholars have been so critical of Sitchin. Not because they're too close-minded or anything like that, but rather because Sitchin really doesn't seem to know what he's talking about. Let me give you an example of how Sitchin comes up with his, quote, amazing translations. Let's take this idea that the Sumerian texts speak of mining gold. Now, since the Sumerian texts do not speak of mining gold in any way, Sitchin has to construct this idea out of thin air. This is how he did it. I'll read from his first book, The Twelfth Planet. Quote, some Mesopotamian hymns to Ea exalt him as Bel-Nimiki, translated Lord of Wisdom. But the correct translation should undoubtedly be Lord of Mining. In classic Sitchin style, he never gives any reason that the, quote, correct translation should undoubtedly be Lord of Mining. He just says it should be and leaves it at that. Again, we have Sumerian dictionaries written by the Sumerian scribes themselves, and the Sumerians don't agree with Sitchin here. So why should we? I think one way to demonstrate how bad of a translation this is to read a little about EA or Inki's wisdom in context and let you see if it makes sense to you as meaning wisdom or if it really means mining. This is an example from a Sumerian text called Enuma Elish. It says, "He who understands all, the wise one, the great one, EA, who knows all that is, perceived the plot, he countered it with a powerful spell." Not only does it describe his wisdom further here by saying, quote, "he who understands all," but it also says that because of this wisdom, he was able to perceive the plot before it happened and counter it. None of what we just read makes sense if wisdom really means mining. Here's another one from the same epic. EA, who knows all things, knew he could not defeat Kingu and the hosts of Tiamat. Here again we see a contextual definition of EA's knowledge. He knows all again. We see that his knowledge helped him understand that he could not defeat Kingu. These are not isolated descriptions of this knowledge. EA is the god of wisdom for a reason. Nothing said about him makes sense if his knowledge means mining, or even knowledge about mining. All the stories about him highlight his great understanding, and conversely, there isn't even a hint that he cares a lick about digging for gold or anything else. It's just not there. It requires an ignorance of the Sumerian texts in order to be believed. To sum up, almost everything that Ancient Aliens says about the Anunnaki is untrue, which is not surprising considering they copy and pasted almost everything in this section from the books of Zachariah Sitchin. For more information about Sitchin's errors in his translations of the Sumerian and Akkadian texts, I would direct you to the excellent website of Dr. Michael Heiser, SitchinIsWrong.com. I would also ask you to take a long, hard look at the authors and speakers and charismatic personalities that led you to believe some of the things that I hope you can now see are wrong. I hope that this film helps you to realize that they are not as smart as they have led us to believe, and to consider what else they may have taught you that isn't true. We shouldn't allow ourselves to be taken in by this kind of thing. We must be people with higher standards when it comes to verifying what is true.
Do not become enslaved to an authority figure. They should always be willing to direct you to information so that you can do the work and you can check on them. If they don't, you should be suspicious. Again, this is just something that as a professor, as a scholar, I try to get my students to consider and think about, because let's face it, how many of us are really into this kind of stuff? Ancient languages, how many people do that? You get somebody who comes along like Zechariah Sitchin and starts spouting things about Sumerian and Akkadian and Hebrew and whatnot. How many people really have the ability to check up on them? Well, the answer is not many, and it just sounds like a horrible amount of work to gain that knowledge so that you can evaluate what they say, and I understand that. But you should not let that allow you to check your brain in at the door. You should ask that source, that person, hey, where can I look? What can I do? What can I access to try to test what you're saying?